The topic I want to talk about today is, you may have heard this before, open innovation. Do you know this term, open innovation? Does it ring a bell? No? Okay. Open innovation, in a way, has to do with all these things that have been done in the past. So if you talk about innovation obviously is you do new things, right? You innovate your business, you innovate your industry, you innovate your applications, you innovate your thinking. And to do all this, there's different techniques on how you can do it. There have been techniques in the past that we will talk a little about. There's techniques of the future. And if you go to conferences like I do, and you also get into the circles where politicians start to talk about the future, and this is a really dangerous place then, and I just was in Hannover. In Hannover, Germany, we have the big industry show. It's not CeBIT, but it's the Hannover Fair. And Germans do machines, and we like to do machines for some reasons. So Italians have good food. We are not good in food, so we focus on food processors, for example. So machines that produce food for Italians. And that's not an example of a food processing machine, but we are really good in producing food, but cars and machines. That's really how we make money in Germany. And now, when you talk to all these people, they say, wow, there's so much happening in the world, and there's the Internet 2.0, the Web 2.0. We need something for industry too. So industry, we need industry 4.0. That's a buzzword in Germany. And there's many, many millions of dollars is actually, or euros, is being poured into this event. And if you look at this picture, obviously, it's not ready for production. It's mocks. It's very interesting early technology, and there's a million and millions of people and engineers and companies are investing into this. If you look at Industry 4.0 in a different way, it's a very simple picture, actually. Unfortunately, I didn't translate the text on the side, but it doesn't really matter. On the top, you have SAP, the ERP system, and down on the bottom, you have a ton of actuators and sensors that run these machines, that operate the robots and get some sorts of signals from above, from the SCADA, from the steering committee, if you want so. Then on top, there is something called MES, which basically connects different plants or different machines. Yeah, and then information goes up and down, and it goes horizontal as well between the different machines. And that's a typical example today of a German engineering and something that is called closed innovation. Why closed innovation? Because all these things, all these protocols, all this communication in every place is very, very proprietary. So if you buy, that's the good news about for the German industry, if you buy from one German guy, you have to buy all the rest from another German guy, or even the same German guy. So we lock you up. Isn't that nice for us? So nobody else can actually, if you are an Italian machine maker, let's say, and you want to connect to this, you have to buy licenses from us to hook into our proprietary protocols. Otherwise, we won't let you in. Now, this has worked very well for a couple of years. There's a problem with that. You cannot really drive the innovation anymore, because if you looked at this, if you look at this very, very closed environment, what happens is we Germans and all other peoples who do this type of open innovation, they research for 5-6 years and they hide away in basements and they develop all that stuff. And then they come out with this wonderful new thing. Or at least they think it's a wonderful new thing. And guess what? Other people tell them, nah, that's not what we wanted. Too bad.
So what do? You go back and hide again for 5 more years and develop everything yourself, and you come up and you have a second mistake, and then you are bankrupt. Even as a large company, IBM, for example, has gone through this experience when they were developing in the 80s and 90s all these wonderful new software stacks and this new hardware, to show up in 95 and say, hey, we got this great new thing here. And everybody said, yeah, you know, we don't want these type of mainframes anymore. We actually now use Unix servers and Windows PCs. And IBM said, oh my God. And they were almost bankrupt. Interesting. So closed innovation, you can describe best if you say you do a lot of research yourself, you do all the development yourself, you don't look outside what's happening outside, and you don't allow anybody to look inside and demonstrate what you are doing. Another company that has gone this route in the past was Airbus. Airbus has developed something really special in the 80s. It was the A320 plane. A320 was the first plane that was flying with a system called steer-by-wire. Do you know that? Fly-by-wire? Yeah. It's really all software and electronics rather than mechanical strings to steer the airplane. And it got even worse. Not only was it just a little electromotors, but it was a whole flight system. So the flight system, the software actually told the pilot what to do, and the flight system had the right to override the pilot, and pilot said so, and the system said, no way, this way, right? And to do that, you need to really test your system very well. Now, they did this. They went through all sorts of efforts. They internally developed incredibly good software to describe the system, to design the system, to implement the system, and to test it. And then they said, phew, this was tough. A320 went flying in 1982, I think. Development actually started sometime in 1972. And they outsourced all their software tools, like their testing environments. And they were happy. And things looked really good. And then they found out, wow, for 78 years, we actually need to change the software in these airplanes, approximately 78 years. So life cycle of such a plane, if nothing bad happens, is 70 years. Of a model, it's now actually, if you still see the A320s flying, and right now they are attaching the fin sharks to the A320. That's some sort of an attachment to the wing outside to keep the vortex around the wings smaller, so they have to go and retest all their software if it's still okay. Unfortunately, they cannot do this anymore because some of the software doesn't exist. It went bankrupt with the company that went out of business. So they had to rewrite all their assets. And that was really bad news. They could not innovate anymore. They lost all the capabilities because it was done in-house and then continued in some other firm. So they had really bad defects in what they call their ecosystem. And the worst defect was, or the two bad things were, A, we cannot continue to innovate what we had because it was locked away in an open innovation company, in a closed innovation company. And the second problem that they had, they could not keep their assets over the lifetime. So they couldn't. They had software assets that they needed for life, but they couldn't keep it, they couldn't sustain it. So they almost got to a point where they were grounded with their airplanes, which is really bad if you have an airplane company, right? Now, they asked themselves, how can we continue here? What can we do? And to the surprise of myself and others, they decided that in the future, for all these very crucial elements in their software stack, and I think you will hear a little later from Sylvia about Polasys, they decided to do everything in open source in the future. So the complete opposite of what your CIO might have told you. Interesting approach. Why do they do this? Because they tried to, they noticed that in order to continue innovation, you need to have a lively ecosystem that can look into your stuff, where you can contact and talk to the outside, and where you have a continuous exchange of ideas, of thoughts, of components, and so on, to really continue to innovate your systems. Otherwise, companies like Airbus, these users of software that don't really have the full access to the entire software or had it in the past, are doomed and going out of business. If you look at these guys again, what should they do? Obviously, on all these levels where communication happens between the different systems, they also need to become open. So when you look at this level here, SPS, you basically need to go and say, hey, we cannot allow, we Germans, we must not allow anymore that there is protocols used that that only one company has the rights to, because this will hinder innovation. If you look at the lines that go on the vertical, we also need to take care if we want to become Industry 4.0, where you can mix and match machines, where you can have different generations of machines, where you allow this type of thing, we actually need to also be open enough and allow the communications to be open. This is the first and foremost decision that the Industry 4.0 people have to make. And this is also a decision that, for example, IBM had to make in the past. This gentleman, who knows him, anybody? Yeah, some of them have seen him at a keynote at our German conference. He explained through what trouble IBM actually went when they were challenged by Microsoft's operating system to basically coming to a point where Microsoft had captured the developer world with their .NET, was it .NET? .NET technology. IBM had already lost the PC. They had OS 2. Microsoft had Windows. Windows was conquering OS 2 and destroying OS 2 like in a hurry. Nobody was using OS 2 except a couple of banks. And now IBM was attacking their backend servers with .NET. And these guys actually had to make a bold decision. They had to say, we need a platform. We need a platform really quickly, and we need to open up this platform. So they collaborated with others and came to the idea that they want to use Java in the future. So this was in the late 90s of the last century, long time ago. And these guys said, but we need more. It's not just enough that we have this open platform. We also need to have tools. We need to allow people to develop in this open platform, and we need to keep the barrier of entry very low so that we have a very broad approach, very many people starting on that. And this is where Eclipse came into life. These guys actually liberated Eclipse for the software industry and gave us a very good example on how open innovation can work. You allow people to access assets and you create a workplace. This has led to an ecosystem that basically covered all of the software industry except Microsoft and a couple of others. But it started a large collaboration, and it got the Java platform, despite of some delays that were in the development of Java, to become the most prominent server platform even until today, and collecting all these companies around it. And what we saw is it did not only spread out to the software industry, but there was other companies that were software users, like car makers, telephone makers, people that did big systems like SPSs and so on, and industry systems, they also started to like the idea. And when we heard more about Eclipse, what it showed also is that even in this open innovation space, you can be predictable, you can be productive, and you can deliver. So we got to an basically an industrial approach of open collaboration, where 400 companies per year, or people from 400 companies, can ship in time in an open source way. Very interesting. So if you look at it, these guys from IBM created an ecosystem with millions of users, with many thousand products that ship today, with about 1,000 full-time developers, more or less, that built this platform that can be consumed by the others. Hundreds of companies. Oh yeah, predictable schedules, but that's normal. Everybody ships predictably. World-class intellectual property management, 17 employees. Actually, by July, it will be 18. And zero product managers who manage this type of stuff. Since we are running a little out of time already, I'm skipping over this, but the interesting word here is platform. We need a platform. So what we really produced was a platform that allows an ecosystem to grow on top. And this is the message that you please take home with you. We talk about ecosystems consisting of platforms. Platforms need to be open, like in this Industry 4.0 picture. What you saw is there's a platform for machines, for communication. The communication needs to be free, and everybody else can provide his niches, his little machines to connect to this platform, or his system, SAP system, whatever. So based on this platform, things will start growing. Sylvia, you will talk about Polasys in a second. Polasys was one of these platforms. So Airbus, coming back to the former Airbus example, decided they want to build a tool platform. And they invited many other companies to participate in this tool platform. They just said, we need to have this type of components, this type of infrastructure. We are using Eclipse modeling technology as the underlying platform. And on top of it, we will have many companies collaborate to build this, all the tools that we need. And this worked quite well for them. They were forming an ecosystem that included their supply chain, that included a lot of small enterprises to bring these tools, these components to the table. And many of these are actually also to find in the Eclipse ecosystem. They were early able to integrate schools and universities to test and give feedback. So the feedback loops on what they were producing were quite close. And they were able to take research from research institutions and collect it also and integrate it also into this tool chain very early. So within 4 years, think about it, starting from pretty much zero, and an idea, or actually it was 5 years, 2004 to 2009. In 2009, the first version of Polasys of Topcase, as it was called at the time, shipped and was able to be, at least in parts, getting into production. In 2011, Airbus declared success and said, this is the right way. We finish the prototype phase and we go into production phase. Very interesting. And they, even today, they paint a picture and say, this is where we want to be in 2014. And to all their competitors, to all their suppliers, they show this picture and say, if you are not within the, what is this color called, within the orange, you are in trouble. You might be replaced by our open source solutions. So we invite you to join us. But if not, you're out of business, at least with Airbus and its suppliers. So that is also openness. They tell you early how you can participate in the ecosystem. We see the same thing actually happening in other industries. We have an automotive industry came to Eclipse, and not only to Eclipse, they also found their own open source projects nowadays, like Genevi, for the development of the in-car entertainment systems. They also work on tools for motor control, for the distribution of software within the car, and so on. They found the same ways. They are not software makers, but they are going the same. They are using the same strategy as IBM and Airbus to basically manage their supply chain and tell them what it is they have to do. And if they don't do it, that's too bad. We see the same thing happening in the defense industry. So the Department of Defense in the US, where you think open source in defense, isn't it all about secrecy and not telling anybody else? But no, these guys are becoming big open source users because they found out that this is also a very good way to create open collaboration. We see the same thing in public transport. The German railway is going a similar approach because they found out, I know it's different in maybe here, but in Germany we were not able to bring the latest generation of our fast trains, the ICE, onto the tracks. For 3 years now, the suppliers have failed to ship this new train because they were not capable to control the software within the trains. And Siemens was doing something and nobody knew about it. They came out 1 year later, and guess what? They were rejected. They got another year. They came back and now we do it right. They did some more closed innovation, more closed job, came back, failed. So the German railway, Deutsche Bahn, has now decided that from now on, these types of things, and mostly the let's say, very crucial software development for these types of systems have to happen in open source. This was a big surprise for the industry, but for the German railway, the only way of how they can at least hope to be successful in the future. We talked about cars. We see the same thing in trains. Power supply, so when we look at new power networks, similar types of approaches, they all go into this open innovation type of stuff. Collaboration in the Internet of Things, many, many devices that need to have common protocols, that need to have common software layers in order to communicate. Unfortunately, there's no free lunch. This all costs, and what we found out, what we learned at the Eclipse Foundation, by working with all these groups and observing all these groups, is that you need a couple of things in place in order to organize this collaboration. You need a good governance model. You need to understand who owns what. You need to understand how to develop things together. You need to understand who calls the shots. You need to allow people to work on a similar basis. If it's controlled by one or even many or a few, then it's not a fair ecosystem anymore. So what we tried to set up at Eclipse is some type of structures where we offer to these organizations a platform for collaboration. We call this industry working groups, and that's a very new concept where we invite these types of industry organizations to come to us and organize themselves. And Polasys will be one example that we discuss later on. You are talking about LTS. So LTS, when you listen to Jutta later on, another example on how these organizations build their own Eclipse Foundation inside the Eclipse Foundation, if you want so, and get themselves organized. Before I close, one little advertisement. You learn more about this effort at our French conference, which is going to happen on June 5th and 6th in Toulouse. Toulouse is almost as nice as Florence. So if you want a break from Florence and learn some French, come on over, join us. And if you want to learn more about the concept of industry working groups and how the Eclipse Foundation provides governance for these types of groups, there are two links that I would share with you. And you can as well, of course, contact me and I will give you more information. And this was it. Thank you.